We are here to work on the last section of chapter 15. This section deals with insoluble salts. If you'll remember from chapter 14, we worked with soluble salts, ones that completely dissociate 100% in water. With this section, we are included in this chapter because these systems set up equilibrium. We will not be calculating pH with these salts, but we can still predict if they are acidic, basic, or neutral. One of the first things to recognize is how we identify whether a salt is going to be soluble or insoluble. We will be referring to the solubility rules in our blue periodic table. If you don't have that handy, go ahead and pause the video and grab it. Remember, if you need another copy, there is one available on our homepage of Canvas. If you have your blue periodic table handy, we're going to be going through this list of salts and identifying whether they are soluble or insoluble. Again, please pause the video, take a second, and identify what they are. If you're back with me, we are determining whether each salt is essentially going to be solid if we form it as the product of a reaction or whether it would be aqueous. If we check rule number three, bromide, silver bromide is one of our exceptions that would be insoluble or solid. Sodium nitrate is going to be aqueous or soluble. Lead 2 chloride is insoluble. Iron 3 hydroxide is also insoluble. Ammonium chloride, hopefully you recognize from chapter 14, is a soluble salt. Silver sulfide is going to be solid, and calcium carbonate is going to be solid. So again, it's the solid or insoluble salts we work with in this section. But realize that even though we say that these salts are insoluble, they will still dissolve to a small extent, and this is where equilibrium is established. Just for reference, you don't need to memorize these values, but the cutoff for the solubility rules depends on how much salt will dissolve in 100 milliliters of water. So the general rule of thumb is if more than a gram will dissolve in 100 mils of water at room temperature, it's considered soluble. If less than 1 gram will dissolve in 100 mils, that is considered insoluble. Because we're going to be discussing equilibrium systems again, we have a new equilibrium constant, our KSP value. The SP stands for solubility product. And again, that is a great hint as to what type of system we're working with. So when you see KSP, you know you're working with an insoluble salt. KSP values are measured at the saturation point for a salt. Quick reminder of definitions with solutions. So remember, the solute is the solid we add. The solvent is the liquid that we put it in. And those are determined by relative amounts. So the solute is the smaller amount, solvent is greater amount. For our purposes, we always work with water in this section. So water is going to be our solvent. We can call a solution unsaturated if we could still dissolve more solid into it. So when you make your large pot of water to make pasta, you have an unsaturated solution. You've only added a little bit of salt. The saturation point is when our solution can't dissolve any more solute into it. So we've reached the maximum point of dissolving solid. It is possible to make a super saturated solution. And in our Canvas page, I've linked a video to a demo. It's my favorite demo to do, and I'm really sad I can't do it in person with you, but super saturated sodium acetate. So check out that video. It's very cool. But we will be referring specifically to the saturation point for salts to determine KSP. So again, KSP is called the solubility product constant. And again, important to remember that all of our equilibrium constants are temperature dependent. And this is even more true with insoluble salts. Remember that as we heat up water, we can often dissolve more solid in it. And so that would change the saturation point for a given solution. So for KSPs, like we did with acids and bases, we will assume we're working at room temperature, 25 degrees Celsius. We're going to work through two examples here, writing the equation of dissociation. So remember, dissociation we discussed in chapter 14 with our soluble salts. This equation is also referred to as dissolution with the insoluble salts. So dissociation or dissolution is just writing the equation showing our salt breaking apart into the ions. So silver bromide breaks apart into one silver ion with a plus one charge and one bromide ion with a minus one charge. Lead 2 chloride will break apart into one lead ion with a 2 plus charge. And then paying attention to our stoichiometry here, we will produce 2 chloride ions in solution. So those are our equations of dissociation. Now we also want to look at how we would write the equilibrium expression for these. And the same rules apply that we've been using all along. We're still going to write products over reactants. We still use our coefficients as the exponents. And one more key thing to remember is physical states. Remember that solids and liquids never get included in expressions. And so we actually won't have anything in the numerator because silver bromide and lead 2 chloride, in fact, all of our reactants are always going to be solid. And so our equilibrium expression for this one would just be, pardon my horrible handwriting, would just be silver concentration and bromide concentration, each with an exponent of 1. For our second equation, we would have lead 2 plus concentration times chloride ion with a minus 1 charge, but that would be squared. And so in a little neater form, here we have those equations with the expressions. And just for reference, I've included the relative KSP values so you can see how they compare. The figure at the bottom on this slide is showing what happens when we take our salt and dissociate it in water. Again, illustrating that it's setting up equilibrium and not very much of this salt dissociates. So most of it actually stays together as the undissolved salt, and that should make sense. This is silver bromide in the figure, and so we see that with a KSP value of 10 to the minus 13, that is a very reactant favored system, meaning the salt does not dissolve very easily. So the two questions you should be able to answer are, what does a large KSP value indicate versus a small KSP value? And I just referenced this as a reminder. The smaller a KSP value, the more reactant favored. The larger the KSP means it is a product favored system, or more product favored. And again, we only use KSP values for the insoluble salts. Hopefully you would recognize that our soluble salts in chapter 14 would have essentially values of infinity for KSP. They're so product favored that we have none of our reactant left over. So the larger a KSP value, like lead 2 chloride, the more soluble that salt is relative to silver bromide. I'm going to have you pause the video, and I want you to work on writing the dissolution or dissociation equation and KSP expression for calcium phosphate. When you have those done, play again, and we'll come back to the solution for that. All right, so we are back to work on our dissolution equation, and I'm actually going to delete what I had written before. I just work on handwriting this. So if you noticed on the previous slide, strong recommendation here is to review nomenclature. It is fair for me to give you the name of a salt. You have to write the correct starting formula so that you can then write all of the correct information from it. So calcium phosphate, calcium has a 2 plus charge. We have 3 of those to balance out our 2 phosphates. Each of those has a 3 minus charge. So two things to pay attention to when you write your products here. One is the charge of the ion. The second is the stoichiometry. What is the ratio of each ion in here? I have three calciums and two phosphates and their appropriate charges. So that's dissociation. Our next step then is to write the KSP expression. So again, we're writing the formula of the ion, calcium 2 plus. That coefficient becomes the exponent. And same thing with phosphate. I have my ion with its charge and the exponent of a 2. The last slide for this video is to just illustrate the varying values we can see for KSPs. As always, you do not need to memorize these. You'll either be given the value or asked to calculate it. But it is interesting to note that we do have precipitate colors in here. It's very helpful to note those so that when you get something that's non-white, it can be very helpful, like here with the iron 3 hydroxide. That makes it relatively easy to identify in a lab setting. If you do ever need to look up KSP values, be sure you're using the textbook values, especially for homework. So Appendix J, or I have it linked on our Canvas site for this chapter.